Sir, Angappan sir,
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
I will do one thing. I will send you my PPT slide. You
No,
can you
no,
open
sir.
from your window so that we can talk if someone is trying to.
Yes. Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Can you perhaps identify who is trying to mute, sir?
I am searching the.
That is the case. Actually, permanently we can delete
Yeah,
them
delete it, delete them.
From such kind of you know. So, dear students, what do you see here? Actually, global outlook, that is global energy outlook. What is that? How much energy we are using, how much energy that we may require in future, all these things displayed in that slide. Wait a minute. Sir, Rangappan sir, it's coming to your Rediff.
Okay, sir.
Yeah. Perhaps you can, you know, open it and keep it ready, sir. Yes, it is there. Okay, so we all know that energy is a central societal problem which really impacts our human life, economy, environment, health, of course, national security. So what do you see here, this chart diagram is the amount of energy that we are consuming. That is, we are at 2020, look at this, almost 20 terawatt energy that we are consuming. For your information, I am giving 1 terawatt is equal to 10 power 12 watt. So that much amount of energy that we are consuming. What happens after 30 to 40 years? The amount of energy is almost doubled, 15 to 30, 35, 40 terawatt. Okay, so the projection says that after 30 years, the amount of energy that we are going to consume would be doubled or tripled. Now, keeping that in mind, the Nobel laureate has already coined that we will be having trillions of money, but there won't be enough energy resources. Sir, can you open, sir?
Not yet, sir. Not yet received.
Okay, okay.
So you can proceed, sir. In the meantime, you can proceed.
Sorry. Yeah, I'm proceeding, but I am not able to move my next slide.
Mm-hmm. It will take some few seconds. It will take some few seconds.
Yeah, you see different, you know, the energy sources. Okay, so whatever energy sources are available. Most importantly, the renewable energy sources. So actually, I must tell you the fact that the renewable energies are seasonable, right? If you want to use energy, you cannot ask sun to shine or you cannot instruct the wind to blow for some time. So whenever it does its job, you must be in a position to store those energy. So that's where these electrochemical energy storage systems are becoming more and more important. So that's where we are focusing electrochemical energy storage systems. Okay, so what do you see here? Again, the energy consumption of the fossil fuels. So we all know that fossil fuels, natural gas, coal, oil, and other things. If you look at the past, you see that there is actually dominant in the past. Of course, the future also up to 2020, the fossil fuels would be dominating. It's clear from this, you know, source of information. So look at this. So what are the other alternative system that we need to focus? Look at this: geothermal, solar, wind, biomass, and hydroelectric. And these are the actually the overview of energy sources. And what are the alternative energy technologies? So as I mentioned that renewable energy has issue with the intermittent. For that, you should have alternative energy sources. So fuel cell capacitor and batteries are collectively called electrochemical energy storage systems. And solar, wind, nuclear, hydro, geothermal, all the other alternative systems. So electrochemical energy storage and technology is broadly classified into three categories based on the mode of charge storage: batteries, fuel cell, and capacitors. So all these three collectively called electrochemical energy and conversion system. As far as fuel cell concerned, that is called conversion system. Batteries and supercapacitors are energy storage device. Further, you know that energy, the batteries are classified primary battery and secondary battery. Of course, capacitor are broadly classified into two categories, that is pseudo capacitor and double layer capacitor. Look at this. What are the challenges that we face, all these electrochemical energy storage system? Limited energy and power density, and cost, safety, of course, the durability. So electricity kind of chain, what do you see here? We need to produce electricity. It has to be transmitted from one place to other place, and that place where you need to store the energy. So that's where storage is important. So where do we begin? So we begin with oxidation and reduction. So we all know that historically oxidation is the reaction with oxygen. So wherever oxygen is adding, that we call as oxidation. So the reduction, the removal of oxygen. So this is actually oxidation and reduction. And commonly called, these are redox reactions. So loss of electron by one substance, oxidation. The other one is reduction. So this is actually a memory device. We see in school days, we remember, okay, Leo, the line says GER. So that means what is oxidation? Loss of electron is oxidation, gain of electron is reduction. By these kind of things, students, we will never forget the concept of this oxidation and reduction. So that's why we are taught with these kind of memory aids. Look at this. This is really the big revolution happened in this kind of energy storage technology system. So what do you see here? These four pictures clearly gives you the revolution, what happened. Look at the top two images. So the top left, what you are seeing is a Belgium car powered with the lead acid battery. And of course, during that time, actually these phones, mobile phones, the weight of these phones were that time about 2 to 3 kgs. So after the well revolution happened during the 90s, 70 and above, you see here, this is actually lithium ion batteries powered Tesla car. And of course, this, you know, smartphone, what you are using to attend the class or talking, whatever it is. If you look at the weight of this smartphone is 100 to 200 gram, the maximum. So more than that, you see here, actually, you have power backup and a lot of application built in that. So these are things clearly shows that we have already made a revolution in this energy storage technology. And what do you see here? Lithium ion technology in portable market. So before 90s, what is this? Whatever you see here, actually, the audience, they are trying to listen the event. Let's assume there's a cultural event, so people are trying to enjoy the event. After 2010s, what do you see here? Everyone is holding their mobile phone, trying to capture those images. But I'm sure that almost 90% of our people will not reuse or will not revisit those pictures. Okay, so this is the difference happened. So what is this technology changes made this kind of transition? Look at these all happened due to the lithium ion battery developments. So now let me tell you what is Raghun plot. Raghun plot is the important plot in the case of energy storage and conversion device. Whatever the device you develop, immediately you will try to fit into this plot. That is Raghun plot. Is basically energy density versus power density. So I must define what is energy density. Energy density is the amount of energy that is stored per unit of weight or volume. Power density is nothing but how fast you can use that energy. That is called power density. So you must be clear at the end of your class, you will be asked what is energy density. You should know that amount of energy per unit of weight or volume. Power density is the amount of how fast you can use that energy. You can also look at this cartoon. And you see here the large amount of energy stored on the right hand side. Of course, on the left hand side, you see here actually you can quickly transmit those power, those energy stored in that, because due to the wider neck. So that is how fast you can make use of this energy. That is called power. You can also recall the other scenario, 100 meter running race and marathon race. For marathon race, you need to put lot of energy, but it's not a quick power. But 100 meter, you have to make, very quick. So that is your power density. So batteries, the history is not new actually. 7,000 years ago, Augustine battery was the first. There is actually big, the source of information, what you see here, yeah, Sanskrit. The version written here, Magarishi Agastya. A clean copper plate is put in the earthenware vessel. It is covered first by a copper sulfate and then moist sandwich. After that, put a mercury amalgamated zinc. These are things clearly shows that even ancient days, electricity was known. Look at this. Mitra, Varuna, Pranavayu, Udanavayu, all these things we are familiar, right? So Pranavayu, oxygen, what we breathe, Udanavayu, hydrogen, these all in the atmosphere. And you see 100 cells in the series to convert energy. That is Sada. We used to say Sada. And then, Apsara, watertight vessel. So these are the history, if you look at in the battery. So these are the containers they used those days to make it. See the container, terracotta jar, copper cylinder. This is iron rod. On that, in between, you have vinegar as an electrolyte. Here, the separator and non-ionic conductor. So these all things clearly show this is actually Baghdad batteries, maybe approximately 2000 years ago. Now, this is actually the history little bit, whatever we learned from our textbook. Look at this Galvani. Basically, Galvani was a, physician. He was a surgeon. He was trying to develop a bioelectricity for his application. So he ended up with animal electricity. Probably you all know that. So he is trying to touch with the two different metals on the legs of frog. Then he found there is something happened. So he assumed that that was the electricity. And in between, Volta came. No, it's not like that. There was a two different metal that is responsible for your electricity. So that's the generation of formation of the electricity happened. Now we are familiar with the Daniell cell coupling with zinc sulfate and copper sulfate, zinc, and so on. Now lead acid battery. Look at this. Why lithium ion batteries are so fascinating? Probably all of you are aware about the portable devices, cell phone, laptops, camera, whatever you see there, you will find lithium ion batteries. So, and also you heard these lithium ion batteries are so powerful, right? Why? How? So that is the answer is in this slide. Look at this energy density. What do you see here for lithium ion batteries? Almost 150 to 200. And the energy density for the conventional lead acid battery is just 50, right? And what do you see here? So 50, just 50 watt-hour per kg for lead-acid battery. So what does it mean? So you need to have three lead-acid batteries to replace one lithium-ion batteries. So that's where these lithium-ion batteries are so powerful. And how do you calculate the energy density? What do you see here? This formula given for calculating the energy density. Current into volt. We all know that current into volt, it's watt. And watt-hour per kg. That is the unit of your energy density. Why this lithium ion? Because lithium, you all know that it's very soft metal. So weight is in the down, 6.9. Okay, very, very light metal. More than that, you have the redox potential for lithium. If you look at the reduction potential for lithium, lithium gives lithium plus plus electron. That is 3.05 volt. So that is the, if you look at in the, the EMF series, this place top. So these two factors are makes lithium ion batteries are so powerful. Look at this. This is actually knowingly, unknowingly, now everyone is carrying lithium ions in our pocket. Am I right? Because all our cell phones contains lithium ions inbuilt. Look at this. This is the scheme for working principle of lithium ion batteries. What do you see here? This is actually now discharging. On the other hand, you will see a charging. okay, this is a simple electrochemical reaction, so I'm not going to detail of all these things. So only the message that I want to pass on to you is that there is a relation between thermodynamics and electrochemistry based on this relation, delta G is equal to minus N of E. So he is the gentleman who had proposed the first lithium battery. It's not lithium ion, lithium battery, where he used two metals, that is molybdenum disulfide and metallic lithium. And he could see some of the issues with this kind of battery system. What are the issues? You know, the dendrite growth. What is dendrite growth? Dendrite growth is kind of, fibers. It's produced on the metallic lithium. So once started growing the fibers, it will puncture your separator. So I will show you what is separator in the upcoming slides. Okay, so the scheme would look like this. This is actually in the first slide, first cycle, there is clean surface. After few cycle, you see here, there is a formation of the dendrite growth. So this is the actually issue with the metallic lithium. So after 90s, you know, this is a marriage of electrochemistry and solid state chemistry. Solid state chemistry has a lot of intercalation compounds, layer and tunnel, olivine and so on. There are a lot of compounds. And this compound is coupled with the chemical potential that forms as a voltage. So that's where we say marriage between electrochemistry and solid state chemistry. You know, after this Kodak camera incident, so Moly company was silently agreed that there was a issue with the metallic lithium. So you need to replace the metallic lithium. So these are the vast material found in this lithium ion based technology. What you see here, these are all cathode, these are all anode. So you have to be careful when you combine these two to make a battery. So this is actually the small scale to large scale. Look at this from the starting from medical application to large scale storage of this energy from solar and wind. So this lithium ion has made a big breakthrough. Look at this, the history, 90s, you know, Sony has commercialized this compound and then later they developed spinel and olivine and so on. Now we are in the different chemistry. I'll show you in the upcoming slides. So this is one of the compound that we have tried. There was an issue with the spinel compound, what you are looking at. This is a wonderful compound due to the strong edge sharing and octahedral. So probably I'll just tell you the issue with this compound. There is a dissolution of active material due to this chemical nature. So we are trying to address this by doping different metal in that. Don't worry about the chemistry involved in these things. Only look at this cartoon. What do you see here? Two different, the manganese dissolution you can see here. This is 50% of 3+ and this is only 30%. You see, when you have less 3+, less dissolution. When you have more 3+, more dissolution. So that means you need to have your optimum composition to make a lithium ion batteries. So these are the materials so far we have been using in the market. Lithium cobalt oxide, spinel, olivine, and of course this is a anode material. Problem with this lithium cobalt oxide, we all know that cobalt is expensive and it's costly. On the other hand, lithium manganese oxide is a spinel compound. We know that this is actually inexpensive. More than that, it is environmentally benign. It's very cheap. In addition, this lithium iron phosphate is another wonderful material offering 160 ampere hour per kg, the capacity. So though the capacity and energy density is almost same of your lithium cobalt oxide, but its problem is less here. Only thing, the conductivity issue that could be solved by adding the conductive carbon. So this is again the landscape. This is very important slides, students. Here, look at this battery technology, how it's evolved. So the second generation, we would say that lithium and the lithium ion cells started with 90s, and then it has taken the next phase during 2010. So that is actually now we are, the other system, lithium sulfur and lithium air and so on. Very importantly, look at this energy density. Whatever we have in the conventional lithium is 200 to 250 watt hour per kg. That amount of energy is not at all sufficient to have a battery for electric vehicle, because you need to have a large amount of energy. So one single charge, you must be able to travel almost 500 miles. But whatever we have now, 200 whatever per kg, the energy is not sufficient. So that's why people are looking for the alternative or the next generation battery systems. So that is lithium sulfur and lithium air. Of course, people are also focusing on sodium ion chemistry. So look at the projection is the twofold increase in the energy density over next 30 years. We all know that if any material, any compound is in the laboratory, that may take 2 to 3 decades to come to the market. So that is the scenario that will also applicable in the energy sector also. Look at this. Probably you are aware about all these things. So the incident here and there, you may hear of the lithium ion explosion. So why it happens? That is due to the oxygen releasing nature of the cathode, lithium cobalt oxide. Though this material is good, but there is issue with this safety. So that's why you need to try to replace such kind of material. So the alternative material is lithium iron phosphate. And also you must remember that the electrolyte what we use in our lithium ion batteries are organic based electrolyte, highly flammable. It may catch fire. And look at this. So what's in store? So look at these two pictures. So some folk predict that the future mode of transport would be either an electric vehicle or a horse. Of course, look at these two. So we have to find out which one we need, because we don't have enough fossil fuels to meet our energy requirement, energy demand. So the lithium air and lithium sulfur are the two next generation material, what I have already mentioned. Look at these two cartoons. So this gentleman is worried about the storage of his battery, because this it contains a lot of battery, for example, lithium ion or whatever the lead acid battery. If you propose some other new chemistry, that is lithium air system, what do you see here? This gentleman is happy because he is not going to store one of the active material in the, inside the car. So what is the one of the active material is air that he is going to directly take from the atmosphere. So that is the advantage we have this lithium air battery. So what is the energy density? Why this lithium air and lithium sulfur systems are so important? Very carefully, if you look at this energy density for this sulfur, 3500 watt hour per kg. On the other hand, for lithium air and lithium oxygen, you see it's almost 5000 watt hour per kg. But you remember in the very beginning slides, you have seen the conventional lithium ion, it's only 150 or 200 watt hour per kg. Now you can imagine how many times more energy that could be stored in lithium sulfur and lithium air. More than that, very importantly, look at the cost of this material, the cobalt that we are conventionally using in our mobile phones and other lithium ion based batteries. The cost of cobalt is $42 per ton. The same quantity of sulfur is just $30. Do you think that we need to pay for oxygen? So right now, no, but we may face a day that we need to pay for oxygen also. So we have to be very careful with that. And this is actually the electrochemical reaction. So I'm not going to explain this. This involves simple the chemical reaction. Both the system have anodic reaction is common because you are going to use the metallic lithium. That is common. So only the difference in lithium sulfur, you use sulfur. In lithium air, you are going to use the air. So by looking at this energy density, you may wonder, you may amaze to see that this much amount of energy. But look at the challenges behind these two systems. So what are the challenges? Challenges for lithium sulfur is, it's well known. The solubility of the polysulfide, actually you have seen that the material dissolution. When you have a battery, the active material dissolves in the electrolytes, eventually you are going to, lose the activity of the battery. So here one of the biggest problem for lithium sulfur is polysulfide. This is the active material is dissolving. In addition to that, we do have low electronic conductivity, as you have seen lithium iron phosphate. Remember, I have mentioned that. Lithium iron phosphate, though it is a good material, the issue with that, the poor electronic conductivity. So these are the challenges we need to address one by one. So just I show you two slides that where we have tried to address the first issue. So that is the solubility of that. So we have specially made some kind of electrode using a flexible glassy fiber based freestanding electrodes. So in that we could trap the polysulfide active material. So these snapshot shows that the polysulfide, that is yellow colored, is being trapped in the additives that whatever we have designed here, glassy carbon and MnO2, CNT we added to enhance the conductivity. So look at this. This is another similar attempt to see that trapping of polysulfide. So we have carefully designed the composition. using MnO2 and Ketgen black. These are carbon, this is, you know, metal oxide. So we could trap that. And another important thing, you look at these two things. So I mentioned the challenges. What are the challenges? So we all know that for any system, the efficiency should be 100. But in reality, it will not be 100. It will be 99, 98 kind of thing. And for this system, it's common. You look at this. This is actually charging and this is discharging. So look at the difference between charging and discharging. Almost 1.9 volt, the difference. Okay, so you need to reduce this over potential in order to enhance the voltage efficiency. So scientists of GLOBE, they are trying to enhance the kinetics, thereby they could reduce the over potential. Look at this red one. By using this gold and platinum as a catalyst, they have reduced to large extent this charging and the discharging potential. So thereby they have enhanced the voltaic efficiency. They are happy in the laboratory. But when you take these to the commercial stage, what happens? So people are not happy because they can't afford the cost of platinum and gold. That is much expensive. So these are things. So you have to have a optimized system where both, you know, the fundamental scientists should also balance the requirement of the, you know, commercial stage where they can afford the cost. And so far we have talked about two systems, lithium sulfur, lithium air, and in the very beginning, lithium ion, lithium cells. Now I'm going to introduce the third topic, that is redox flow batteries. So this is also, you know, our conventional batteries. Only the difference here, you use flow. You use in the form of liquid to store the energy. Whatever you have seen in your previous slides, that is actually the solid material, lithium and lead acid, whatever the battery you see, that is solid active material. But here you use liquids. So that means you can store energy in the form of liquid. So the flow battery is circulation of electrolyte through the cell stacks. So I'll show you how. Yeah, it is not going to the next slide. When someone tried to mute, then it is not moving further. Okay, so basically this flow battery contains two reservoirs or two different tanks that are used to store the electrolytes, anolyte and catholyte. So these electrolytes are being pumped into the cell stacks, what you see here. Yeah, so what are the advantage of these two systems? Yes. So very important point that what you need to note at this stage is the redox flow batteries have the privilege of storing energy and power in the two different mode. So independent operation is possible in this flow battery, which is not possible with your other conventional system. So now can you recall your first few slides where Raghun plot we thought energy density and power density? Okay, so that these two systems can be independently operated. So look at this model. This is your basic device. For some application, you may need more energy. So increase the volume of your electrolyte. Some application, you need more power. Increase the number of cell stacks. In addition to this peculiar advantage, you do also have other advantages like high efficiency, long lifetime, depth of discharge, environmentally friendly. All these things are common. So how does it work? So these electrolytes, as I mentioned, these electrolytes are being stored in the tank or reservoirs. So these electrolytes are being pumped into the cell stacks, as you can see here. So the actual electrochemical reaction is taking place at this junction. So the electrolyte is again circulating to the same container. Okay, so that means it's reusable. And this is a small device made in our laboratory for a redox flow battery. And similar, your lithium ion system, here also you have an evolution of flow batteries. flow battery is not new technology, so it has one history, 1880. From there, now it has taken two different, many different phases, combining your lithium technology also here. So we have taken one of this system, zinc bromine. So the reason behind that, the zinc is abundant in earth, and of course the bromine also we have plenty in the seawater. So this is actually the scheme source, a simple zinc bromine reductible battery, where you have analyte, catholyte, and on. So the issue here, you like your lithium ion batteries. So lithium, you might have heard about the dendrite growth. Similarly, in zinc also you have dendrite problem. So these are the challenges that we need to address. And of course, more than that, for the two reactions should be balanced. That is cathode and anode. Here bromine redox couple is very, very sluggish. So you need to increase the kinetics of bromine. So my PhD student has attempted to enhance the bromine bromide kinetics, as you can see here. Actually, he used multiple carbon nanotube and single carbon nanotube as a catalyst. So the cyclic voltammetrum, it clearly indicates that there is an enhanced current density as well as the peak separation reduction. Very importantly, if you look at this, the potential drop, when you don't use this catalyst, and you will see almost 700 millivolt the difference. The moment you modify the carbon felt as a catalyst, and you could see here the large reduction, almost 50% reduction potential difference. So that means almost 50% increase in the efficiency. There are issues with the bromine and other systems. So here we are trying to develop a new system that is called zinc and vanadium. This is actually a new concept that we have attempted. So this is the progress. So in CSIR Sikri, we are now in the stage of developing 500 watts zinc bromine redox flow battery, though we have initiated with 3 watt. So this is very important system that you can easily transport from one place to the other place. That flexibility we have. And look at the megawatt plan. Actually, this is the tanks which are used to store the electrolyte. Imagine you have a tank half of your football ground, then how much amount of electrolyte one can store. Depending upon the volume, you can have the energy out in terms of megawatt level. So the last part, that supercapacitor, that is capacitor, we all know that it's again storage device. So especially electrochemical capacitor, there are two different types, double layer capacitor and pseudo capacitors. The double layer capacitor charge is stored between the electrode electrolyte interface, but in the pseudo capacitor, due to the electron transfer process. Okay, don't worry about the detailed mechanism of that. So at this stage, okay, you look at the difference batteries and capacitors. What are the difference? You see, battery has high energy density, supercapacitor high power density. Now you can recall your Raghavan plot. Okay, you will realize the difference. And the application of supercapacitor is, we all know that it's starting from the portable device to electric vehicle. These are the application where we use along with battery, we will couple with supercapacitors. And these are the materials, as you have seen, lithium battery and redox flow battery. For supercapacitor also, we have branches of material. It is basically carbon, metal oxide, and polymer. This is actually the generation, how these materials have been developed in the past. So in our lab, actually, we have made a beautiful hollow sphere of manganese oxide. So here, I just want to tell you only one thing, that you look at this calcium and sodium. You know that calcium is 2 plus, sodium is 1 plus. So that is the reason for calcium nitrate based electrolyte, you get high capacitance than the univalent sodium sulfate. Look at this charge discharge curve. And again, these students, look at this actually. See, this is the composite material. This cyclic voltammetrum, what you see here, it's one of the electrochemical technique what we use to measure the current and the potential. Thereby, we calculate the capacity. Look at this. P dot means it's a polymer. V2O5 is a metal oxide. when you operate these two components independently, your capacitance is very less, 90 and 30 farads per gram. The moment you couple these two, you will see that there is a huge difference in the specific capacitance, that is 237 farads per gram. That happens due to the synergic effect between the metal oxide and the conducting polymer. So almost actually the last one, see, it's very important, look at this, probably you would have not heard these kind of things. Lithium ion supercapacitor. So you had supercapacitor, you had lithium ion battery and separately. So what is the new concept, lithium ion capacitor? In your proton plot, you know high power density and high energy density. Okay, so we thought we should combine the battery material with the supercapacitor material so that you can anticipate high energy density and power density devices. So similarly, keeping that in mind, we have made, this is one battery material, we tried to couple with the supercapacitor material. Look at this, when you operate battery material alone, it is 0.6 volt in the aqueous medium, and when you operate the supercapacitor in aqueous, it is 0.8. The moment you couple these two in a hybrid system, that is lithium ion, you will end up with 1.3 volt. For energy density, supercapacitor is equal to half CV squared. So that means you can calculate the energy density by half CV squared. C is capacitance, V is voltage, that is 1.3. So this energy density, what you calculate is different from your, the battery, what you have seen in the very beginning. Okay, this is the process of making a prototype supercapacitor, what you need to make electrolyte and you need to make electrodes and coat on the surface of the, this is stainless steel. We have pre-treated the surface. It has to be rough enough to increase the, you know, binding. And this is the coated one. You can find out the active material mass. So thereby you can calculate the capacitance. So this is the device looks like your supercapacitor. So we are almost at the end. So probably students, what I have tried to give you the overall view of energy, the energy demand, energy consumption, and what kind of the energy storage system you have, starting from lithium, lithium ion, and lithium sulfur, lithium air, and also we talked about redox flow batteries, and the last part we have seen supercapacitor applications. In all these things, so the message that I want to convey is here that the amount of energy that we need in the future would be doubled or tripled. So for that, see, look at this, 28 terawatt to 2050. So for that, to have this much enhancement, what we need to have, we need to develop a new material that could really offer, you know, high energy density, especially what you have seen, lithium sulfur and lithium air. Okay, so look at this, the grass always looks greener on the other side, but alternative technologies should be carefully examined for their long-term sustainability. At this junction, we can also recall, you know, Alan's word, the oil to you know, more than any other time in history, mankind faces, you know, a crossroad. One path leads to despair and utter hopelessness. The other to total extinction. Let's pray we have the wisdom to choose correctly. I must acknowledge Director. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. We have some few questions. Sir?
Yes, sir. Go ahead, sir.
Question.
Yeah.
Sharda Shyam is a PhD biology from Pushal. How renewable energy can be produced and utilized at local level in our country?
Yeah, actually, see, throughout the year, almost 8 months, we'll be having plenty of solar and wind. So that could be produced by using the photovoltaic system. So these energy should be stored. redox flow batteries are is one of the potential storage system that government is trying to you know promote. But all other system also possible in the local. What he is specifically asking about the remote sites. So especially redox flow batteries is specially designed to give the you know accessibility in the remote areas. So that is possible after converting solar energy. So these storage system would be ideal to store that. It is possible to have in the remote area also. So that is the actually idea. That is the motto behind this kind of development.
Yeah. Thank you, sir. Next question is Vithya Arora, PGT Physics, KV Nagpur. Many times we come across the term grid failure. When there is a long power cut, so many questions is how these grids actually work and what does many times we have come across the grid failure. So how do these grids actually work and how does does it mean for the failure of grids?
Yeah, that grid failure is due to the you know power shutdown that happens. But when you connect this renewable energy system, there will be a you know up and down in the night time and the daytime. So when you couple this storage device, so you have uniform distribution of the energy. So that's where you won't see any down in the peak powers. So in the daytime we may need more. So in the nighttime you are not able to generate more energy. So that is why actually you need to couple this system in the grid level. So in order to avoid such kind of drop in the output. So that is possible when you have this storage system combined with the grid level.
Acha. Thank you, sir. So the next Anjita from BSc Physics Department of Physics Thiruvananthapuram, she is asking what are the scope and applications of hydrogen fuel cell in rechargeable energy storage technology?
Hydrogen generation and hydrogen you know storage is a different topic for storage that also has equal importance like lithium and other system. So there are a lot of challenges storing hydrogens. Of course, that is also equally important in the case of you know even electric vehicle and storage of large scale of electricity. So that has equal importance of hydrogen and generation and production. Hydrogen fuel cell also is very very important topic in the current scenario.
Sure, very much. Thank you. Next question is Anamika Unnikrishnan from Kendra Vidyalaya Uttapalam. What all are the environment friendly energy sources that all can adopt without considering economic barriers?
Yeah, it's actually a good question. See, without affecting environmentally system, for example, if you look at two active material, lithium cobalt oxide and lithium iron phosphate, between these two material itself, there are a lot of differences. Cobalt is very toxic in nature. But on the other hand, iron, if you take, it's you know environmentally friendly, and more than that, it is much cheaper. So that means it will not affect your economic barrier. So similar, this is one example. Similarly, you have to have a optimized combination of the active material and the system development and so on. For example, this redox flow battery development, if you make in the smaller scale, then it would cost more, affecting your economic system. But on the same system, when you start making in the large scale, then the cost of these flow batteries would come down. So that's why you have to have a balanced thing to have both environmentally, you know, viable and you know, economically worth storage systems.
Good, sir. Next question is Adil Rupesh from KV Kannur. How to set a renewable energy platform for domestic use? Explain about cheapest renewable energy devices.
Yeah, so now actually we are using solar panels. So that is being, you know, for a domestic application that is being placed on the household applications. But again, these storage system becomes important to use in the all the time. So but whatever we have the solar panel, it's accessible in the during daytime, you have, you know, uninterrupted power supply. But during nighttime, if you want to use, then the storage is important. So these flow batteries are viable to use that renewable energy stored for domestic applications, and even for other large scale also it would be applicable.
So very nice. The next question is NM Siddharth from Kendra Vidyalaya Uttapalam. How can India focus contribute to and develop exclusive technological achievements in a clean energy sources production and storage?
Yeah, that's also another concern actually. See, as far as lithium ion technology concerned, so India is not having that amount of lithium. So that's why India is trying to move other technology like sodium. And as I mentioned during my lecture, lithium sulfur and lithium air. So these technology, though they have high energy density, again we have to depend on the lithium source. That is again the biggest challenges. So that's where the alternative system, so the replacement of metallic lithium with the same performance. So that's why the whole globe is trying to have the alternative active material. Okay, so we have to also think about in the different direction. So as far as lithium concerned, okay, the time being it's managing, but in the future and for the large production, so lithium may not be sufficient. So that's exactly requires the alternative active materials and the system also.
Thank you, sir. The last question is Bavitra Panikar from Kendra Vidyalaya Kottayam. What are the inchargeable energy storage technologies?
What are the?
Inchargeable.
Rechargeable or inchargeable?
Inchargeable.
Inchargeable. So she is trying to mean that inbuilt charge.
Okay. Yeah, yeah.
So whatever you have that, like our cycle dynamo. So what is there in that? So when it is being charged, when it is being discharged, you must be able to charge. So that she is referring. Yes. Yeah. It is possible.
Very nice. Thank you, Dr. Raghupathi, for your wonderful talk. It's really many useful for the students. Thank you, one and all. Thank you for the participants.
Thank you, sir. Thank you. I also want to say something actually. So such kind of lecture, we are spending a lot of time in spite of our busy schedule, but there are some participants, they are deliberately trying to disturb, like unmuting.
So thank you, sir. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you. It's my pleasure. Bye.
Sure. So from next Wednesday. Okay. Thank you for participants. Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir. Thank you.